Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Christ Community Church on this third Sunday of August, August 21st, 2022. A special welcome to all who are here in person, those of you who are here for the first time, and those of you who are worshiping from home via live stream. Just a few reminders before we begin our worship this morning. Thank you for your prayers. Our family came back safely from our family reunion in Southern California. My wife did post on her Facebook jokingly saying that we're Californians now, but then a lot of our church folks said, no, you gotta come back, and don't you worry. She said, forget about it. And we're back safely, and we were just grateful that we were able to celebrate my grandmother's 100th birthday, and filled with a lot of hymns, a lot of singing together, and a lot of praying together. And my grandmother, she is an incredible prayer warrior. A lot of people are confused, like, wait, I thought your grandfather was, 107. That's my paternal grandfather, and then this is my maternal grandmother. Longevity on both sides, which my cholesterol is telling me that I need to get better in order to experience that longevity as well. But thank you all for your prayers, for travel mercies. We are back here safely. Do please pray for my children, because they still think it's Pacific time, so they're still waking up at 10:30 and 11 Eastern time, so please pray for that. But yeah, the worship bulletin was emailed to you, is available at our website as well. If you're worshiping from home, if you have any prayer requests, please send a text message to our one of our elders or deacons, and we'll make sure we'll have that in our congregational prayer this morning. Our God calls us to worship with these words from the psalmist, so I invite us to follow along in the bolded words. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Please join me in prayer. God is spirit, and all those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We are here to rejoice and be glad in it. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we stand in awe of the privilege we have to come before you, to be with our church family as we worship you. Lord, I pray that you may be with us as we give you this worship unto you. Lord, this past week, some of us may have had a long week. Some of us may have had a great week. Some of us may have had a weary week. Some of us may have had an up and down, topsy-turvy kind of week. But Lord, you give us moments like these to get a taste of that incredible grace, to get a taste of the saving power of the gospel, to get a taste of the incredible power of Jesus Christ. That we are reminded that we are not alone, that you never leave us nor forsake us. So Lord, as you greet us, as you call us into worship this morning, would you prepare our hearts, and would you bring us into your presence, O Lord, so that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ can overwhelm us this morning. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. Invite us to rise in body and spirit, and let's take this moment to greet one another and say hi and share God's peace with one another this morning. Yeah. Sing this together. Praise to the Lord.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is the health and salvation. All ye who hear now to His temple draw near, praise Him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who o'er all things so wondrously reigning. Shelters Thee under His wings, He so gently sustaining. Hast Thou not seen how Thy desires have been granted in what He ordained? The Lord who doth prosper Thy work and defend Thee. Surely His goodness and mercy here daily attend Thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do. If with His love He the Lord, and all that is in me adoring. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before me. Let the amen sound from His people again. Gladly for let the amen, let the amen sound from His people again. Gladly for all we adore.
Amen. You may be seated. Our God calls us into a time of corporate confession this morning with these words. But God's firm foundation stands, bearing this seal. The Lord knows those who are His, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. I invite us to take a moment to think back upon this past week. Have there been moments where we felt alone? Have there been moments where we felt by ourselves? Yet the Lord says we are His, that He knows that we are His. I invite us to bring any sins, any burdens to the foot of the cross in this time of corporate confession. Let's go to God. Hear these words of assurance. Whoever conceals his transgressions will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy. We have confessed our sins. We've been assured of our pardon. Invite us now to rise together as one church as we declare our faith with the Apostles' Creed. And we say together in one voice, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Let's declare it to our Lord, my Jesus, my Savior.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love.
You're my comfort.
My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship. The Lord on the earth, let us sing power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
My Jesus, my Savior,
my Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love.
My comfort,
my comfort, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath,
yes Lord,
all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord all the earth, let us sing. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Amen. You may be seated.
Better? Yes. Okay, announcements. Are there any announcements today that aren't in the bulletin? I just want to check with Jen. We're still doing the 28th with the kids, right, Jen? Because that wasn't in the bulletin. The 28th with the kids? Gotcha, good. Okay. Okay, so the bulletin lists the August special offering as Long Island Youth Mentoring. You can still give to that. You know, we take it during the month. August council meeting is going to be the barbecue with Pastor James and Jen. We're having Korean barbecue, so that will be a time of fellowship this month. And then next month will be our regular business meeting. So any business that you have with council, just let us know. We can always discuss it or table it until September. And that meeting is going to be on Wednesday, September 7th. And then next Sunday, the life groups will meet just after service to go over what they want to do for the fall as far as planning for meeting times and where you're going to meet and that kind of thing. And then also we're going to meet with the kids after the service to have pizza and a little fun time to kind of wrap up a VBS that was online since COVID is still happening. So that should be a fun time for the kids. So, and then also for the fall, we're starting up for the fall. So in September, Thursday night prayer starts September 8th. September 10th, Saturday, starts the men's Bible study. And September 13th is the ladies' Bible study. And then other things will be announced as they come, youth group and children's ministry on Sundays. So if that's it for the announcements, are there any prayer requests today? Oh, Elisa, yeah. Okay, great. Yep. I'm sorry, Patty. Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay. Are there any others? Oh, Elisa, yep. Okay, great. Yes, we're still some people traveling, so we'll pray for that. Okay, any others? Okay, let's go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we come before you today. As summer draws to a close and we start to look at the fall and the activities that will happen in church and school and other places, and we, Lord, we just ask that you be with us. And as we get busier sometimes, just keep us ever mindful of you and your will in our lives and your direction. And keep us close, Lord. Let us keep you close to our hearts so that, Lord, we can always be working in your will and working your way in our lives. And we thank you, Lord, for all the activities we have at church that can always bring us closer to you and Remind us of your way for our lives. We just thank you for Pastor James and all the people that lead the different Bible studies and activities. And we just ask that you bless them this season coming up and give them the strength and the wisdom that is needed to lead us in those endeavors. We thank you, Lord, for that. And Lord, we also thank you for the healing that we've seen this past week and this past month. Lord, with Frank coming home, we're so thankful, Lord, that he's home. And we're so thankful to see Jenny here, that she's recovering, and Leora. And we just ask, Lord, for a special blessing on all those in our church that are suffering health issues. Just give the doctors the needs that they can better their future, Lord, and give them strength and whatever they might need to live a fuller life. And we thank you, Lord, for the blessings of medicine and doctors, that we can employ those. And Lord, we also ask a couple of special blessings today. Lord, be with April, Lord. We thank you for her presence, and we ask that you be with her and her family. Give them the healing they need, Lord, and present your face to them, Lord, in whatever way you see fit for their salvation. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, that we know we can ask all these things in prayer and that you hear our prayers. Lord, we also ask for a special blessing on Luana. Be with her, Lord, and give her relief from any pain that she might be experiencing, and give her that comfort, Lord, of your spirit. And Lord, also Patty, give her the comfort of your spirit in times when a family member dies. And Lord, that comfort is so important to us on this earth for those that have left us. Lord, just be with her and her family and give them what they need at this time. And Lord, if there's some of us that can help her, Lord, just lead us to that direction, that we know we might be able to leave some of the burden for them. And Lord, we also ask for blessings on Tiffany as she travels. And those of us that are still traveling, just be with us, guide us, direct us, keep us safe, Lord, and we just ask for your mercies in that. Lord, and if there are any other special prayer requests that we haven't heard today, just hear them, Lord. Hear them from our hearts and guide us through the coming week. Lord, we just ask your blessing as we go forward this week. Be with us today. Be with Pastor James as he delivers your word, and let it touch our hearts as it's needed. And Lord, be with all of us as we leave this place, and grant us your peace as only you can give. In your name, amen.
God is good. And all the time. I took a quick peek at our live stream, and I just want to give a shout out to Frank Watson. He is worshiping right now. Hopefully he's in his Sunday best in his comfortable chair, even though he probably might be complaining to Evelyn, saying, I need this, I need that. But I'm so grateful that the Lord it's really just brought Frank home to his comfortable chair and to get out of the rehab center. And he passed all his tests. That was, as soon as I got the message from Evelyn, I said, did he pass all his check marks with the physical therapist? And she said, that's why he's leaving. So praise God. Prayer works. If you recall, a few weeks ago, it wasn't good. Just to be frank, no pun intended, but it wasn't looking good. Speaking with the Watson family and speaking with their daughters, it just really wasn't looking good. And then, our church family, we rallied together. We the power of prayer, and I believe that's also a testament to prayer. And I still remember my first visit to Frank. When I was allowed, finally, I said, thank you. And he said, for what? I said, for continually battling. And then he said, I just want to go home. Like, but he still had it. And so I'm grateful for that, so thank you, church family, for praying. Just an addendum to our announcements. Next Sunday, we will be outdoors, because a lot of people wanted to end the summer with that, our lawn chair church, our outdoor church. So we'll be outdoors one more time. But while we're outdoors, it's gonna feel like a glorious chaos, is what I'm gonna call it. Where we're gonna have our children, they're gonna be tie-dyeing their shirts for VBS. They'll have some fun and fellowship. And for us adults, we're gonna, as soon as the service is over, we'll move our lawn chairs within our life groups. I'm going to be talking with council to see what kind of refreshments we can have available so that you're munching on something as you're talking. But it'll be an opportunity for your life groups to kind of regroup, reconvene. How's everyone doing? How can we pray for one another? And then also plan ahead for the life groups meeting in the fall. So it'll be a fun time of fellowship. But don't you worry, it will not intrude into boating season, because it's not like we're going to be meeting till 5 p.m. or 6 p.m. But yeah, that's something to look forward to as a church family. The life groups were so life-giving. So I hope it's life-giving for you all. We are starting a new series today. And it's a daunting series because not a lot of pastors like going through the minor prophets because it's not easy. It's hard. But sometimes you need to. At least most of the times you actually need to. So we're going to be going through the book of Micah starting today. So I hope and pray that it feels like a Bible study style sermon as we dive in. So I encourage you to, have your Bibles open as we study together, starting at the first chapter this morning. So we'll be in verses 1 through 16. So the entirety of chapter 1 in Micah. But I'm going to invite us to read just verses 2 through the verse 5. God's word this morning comes to us from the book of Micah, chapter 1, and we'll read verse 2 through 5. Verse 2 to 5 is available on your screens in front of you as well as your bulletin. So I invite us to rise, as we always do at Christ Community, to honor the sacredness of God's holy word. Let's read this together in one voice. Ready, begin. Hear you peoples, all of you. Pay attention, O earth, and all that is in it. And let the Lord God be a witness against you, the Lord from his holy temple. For behold, the Lord is coming out of his place and will come down and tread upon the high places of the earth. And the mountains will melt under him, and the valleys will split open like wax before the fire, like waters poured down a steep place. All this is for the transgression of Jacob and for the sins of the house of Israel. What is the transgression of Jacob? Is it not Samaria? And what is the high place of Judah? Is it not Jerusalem? Amen. You may be seated. Let's go to God in prayer once again. God of peace, God of grace, God of love, God of justice. Thank you for the privilege we have to open up your word. Speak to us now and let these words come to life in our hearts, minds, and souls so that we can be aware of how gracious you are, how faithful you are to us. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. Many times the minor prophets in the Old Testament are overlooked. Some say it's because it's redundant in what the minor prophets have to say. Others say it's too confusing, it's too difficult to understand. But at the same time, many pastors try to avoid the minor prophets because of the explicit focus it has on injustice and salvation. Now, it's hard to study through the minor prophets, but I truly believe that God is bringing us through this to this book for a reason. Now, the prophet Micah is the prime example of what the Hebrews call a poetic form of intensification. Now, the themes of judgment and salvation are repeated three times over, intensifying in this rhythm and pulse. Now, who is Micah. Scripture teaches us that Micah was like the prophet Amos, a man from the countryside who was sent to the big major cities to bring the word of the Lord. Now he shares that he's from a town called Moresheth, which is about 25 miles southwest of Jerusalem. And I wish I had prepared a map for you all. But it was far enough, because it's not like you had a car back then, all right, where, you know, 25 miles is a long way to walk. I don't even want to walk 1 mile, even though I should. But 25 miles southwest of Jerusalem. So that means this person, Micah, is a complete outsider. But he was being used and sent into the city, the capital, for God's will. Something that stereotypically should be the other way around. The capital folks going out to the countryside to share God's will. Now, if we look into the historical context of what's going on, he was there in this time where the northern kingdom of Israel had fallen to the Assyrians. Now, the Assyrians had conquered the northern kingdom and then invaded the southern kingdom at the time of Hezekiah. So, of course, they were then defeated by the work of the Lord, the intervention of God. Now, going back into our passage, now that we see that God is communicating through an outsider, he communicates, but more importantly, he commands the world's attention. Micah gives us these vivid imagery of the Lord descending from heaven onto earth to come with judgment. Probably better than any movie scene you can think of. The Lord just descending down. And here's the imagery. Look at verse 3 with me. For behold, it's not just the Lord is, for behold, you better watch out. The Lord is coming out of his place, and he will come down and tread upon the high places of the earth. Micah was sharing that the Lord is coming because of judgment. But God doesn't stop with the imagery for that prophecy from Micah. Look at verse 4. And the mountains will melt under him, and the valleys will split open like wax before the fire, like waters poured down from a steep place. Oof, that imagery. I mean, if you've played with wax and fire, I mean, you know how it gets, right? But you multiply that into a gravity of the valley, the gravity of judgment because of sin is incredible. If the mountains, think about it this way. I'll put it this way, for a little perspective shift for us. If the mountains and the valleys cannot stand before the Lord, then what hope does sinful and rebellious people have? If the mountains and valleys couldn't stand before the Lord and they're going to melt, the valleys are going to split open, then what hope does sinful and rebellious people have? Many of you know I was born and raised in Southern California, and I was just there with my family and these past couple weeks celebrating my grandmother's 100th birthday. But for those of you who know, Southern California is home to earthquakes. I grew up doing earthquake drills left and right. And I remember vividly some of those earthquakes that happened when I was growing up, like the 94 Northridge quake. I remember. And, I mean, things that shouldn't be shaking were shaking. Things that shouldn't be moving were moving. From chandeliers to hutches to houses, things that should be stable. I mean, even freeway overpasses, we call it freeway in California, not highway or expressway, but freeway overpasses were crumbling down because of this earthquake. So if you get a taste of that crumbling down, what hope will you have on a home that is not on a firm foundation? Probably 0 to 0.5%. If you get a taste of the things that shouldn't be shaking and you see that shake, especially in your life, what hope will you have? God's word of judgment can command the world's attention, but it's also convicting us of our sinful and fallen nature. Why is this all happening? Micah says this in verse 5, all this for the transgression of Jacob and for the sins of the house of Israel. This dramatic, powerful descent of the Lord was only because of the sins of God's people. Now let me pause there. For the people of Judah and Israel, they may feel like that they have every right to think that this prophetic judgment from God is absolutely unfair. If you look at other pagan nations surrounding them and they were more corrupt than themselves, your innate human nature might react and respond with, but hey, what about them? What about them? God, why are you coming after us? Our sin was like, a level 1 status. It's not like level 10 status for that pagan nation. 1 Peter 4:17, for it is the time for judgment to begin at the household of God, and if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? God convicts us of our sins. God condemns the false religions. God condemns the idolatry. God condemns the sins and shortcomings. Micah prophesies the coming judgment on Samaria, the capital city of Israel, the northern kingdom. Verse 6, therefore I will make Samaria a heap in the open country, a place for planting vineyards, and I will pour down her stones into the valley and uncover her foundations. Samaria was the capital. I mean, think about it. If you go and if you say Washington, D.C. is going to be obliterated, I mean, I wouldn't mind with how politics have been going lately, but if we have like a movie scene that says Washington, D.C. is going to be completely obliterated and will be heaps of ruins, that's beyond our imagination. That can't be. But that's exactly what's going on here with Samaria. The sins of Samaria, the sins of the capital cities, were setting the pace for the rest of Israel and Judah, with the worst sins being committed in the largest urban areas. An obliteration of the key capital city. Why? Because of what? A sin. Verse 7, all her carved images shall be beaten to pieces, all her wages shall be burned with fire, and all her idols I will lay waste. What kind of sin, Pastor? We got some idol worship going on. With idol worship going on, the Lord was speaking through Micah to say, enough! The Lord was going to bring it to an end no matter what. That's what I think about right now too, in our present day society. People don't realize we have idol worship going on. Idols of pride. Idols of greed. Idols of, I need to buy a house in order to be successful. No, you don't. Idols of, I need to have a job. I need to have a degree. I need to have a master's degree because bachelor's degrees don't mean a thing anymore. No, you don't. We are living in a time where we're creating these idols. And just maybe the Lord is trying to teach us, even this very moment, enough. Stop creating those idols. Idol worship, temple gifts being burned, wages being paid to prostitutes, sinful practice spread like wildfire in Samaria, which took them further away from the covenant of the Lord. What do you do with all that sin? What is our response when you see all that sin? Praise God that He gives us an answer. Micah prophesizes with this, verse 8, for this I will lament and wail. I will go stripped and naked. I will make lamentation like the jackals and mourning like the ostriches. Just wasn't a, whoops, I guess I sinned. I'm a little upset. Oh well. This is a passionate plea. This was a desperation cry. This was wailing. Micah didn't just share what God had said and just left it at that. Micah was trying to exemplify what God was feeling in that moment, that God, was desperately crying out for us. Micah didn't just yawn after saying all that God wanted to say. Micah cared so deeply that he wept with God's people. Our lament, church, for the brokenness we see in the world, our lament for the injustice that we see, our lament for the division and hatred that we see, our lament for the country and the world going further away from Christ, that should bring us to a lament like Micah is sharing. Too many Christians are busy finger-pointing and saying, well, I'm right and they're wrong. Well, I'm not going to get my information from that. And they're not wailing at the sin. They're not crying out to God for restoration and the redemption for others or even for ourselves. We have way too many people that don't know how to have this anguish and grief and lament when it comes to passionately crying out to the Lord. We have too many Christians that say, oh, look at them. I can't believe that they're living in that sin. And we don't have enough Christians that say, with tears and with passion, hey, Jesus doesn't want you to do that. Jesus is coming after you because he loves you. Jesus wants to show grace for you. He wants to redeem your sin so that you can be able to be restored. That anguish. That plea. We've come to a time where it's all about, oh, here, you know, religion. Oh, it's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. It's like Oprah. It's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. No, but it's not like you're giving it. Sorry, that's a bad joke. Bad example. But church, God is calling us to live into that desperation cry instead of just putting our arms together and finger pointing. If you look ahead to verse 10, Micah says to roll yourselves in the dust. Other definitions, especially in the book of Jeremiah, they use the words, roll yourselves in the ashes. That's the ultimate expression of grief. If you see someone in sin, that shouldn't make you feel, oh, I'm uncomfortable. I can't believe they're sinning. No, that should break your hearts. Rolling yourselves in the ashes is what God's trying to teach us. When we see that sin, when we see that someone living in that sin, rolling ourselves in the ashes, desperately crying out to them and saying, Jesus wants you to stop living like that because he loves you. Come back to the Lord. Scripture is not teaching us to go condemn people and say, oh, you're going to hell because you're living like that. No. God's word of judgment here is saying, here is my desperation cry. Here is my wailing. Not just a little tear, but my sobbing. And if you've seen or if you've sobbed before, wailed before, you can't talk properly. If you're wailing, right? You know, you're like, yeah. If we see someone in sin, that shouldn't just make us uncomfortable. That should break our hearts. That should lead us into this grief and lament that Micah is testifying about. See, God is seeing and judging his people's wicked influence. God's word of judgment here is against oppression, against idolatry, against false prophets. And it's so evident in how the prophet Micah desperately pleads and cries in faith. This grief wasn't about any other grief. If you fast forward to verse 16 at the end of the chapter. Make yourselves bald and cut off your hair for the children of your delight. Make yourselves as bald as the eagle, for they shall go from you into exile. Even the exile of these children from these Judean towns would cause the people to mourn. And for them, they don't need to just say it. They need to portray it as well. You know, if you see someone who is battling cancer and they, you know, going through chemotherapy, and they, you know, they shave their head, right? You know that there's a story. You know what's going on. It's a symbolic gesture that other people who are loved ones, I've seen, my friends included, they shaved their head together when one of our good friends was battling cancer. We all shaved our heads together. My wife won't let me shave my head right now, but we all shaved our heads together. But people asked, what's going on? And we were able to share because that was symbolism right there. It was symbolic in a sense. But what scripture is teaching here is that if you are in this grief, you have the symbolic gesture of people knowing that you are in this grief. You are in this anguish. You are in this plea where you're not sitting quietly anymore when it comes to the sins of the nation, when it comes to the sins of the world. In other words, we human beings need to learn to say, no, we're not okay. No, we're not okay. We need to unlearn what the world says when it comes to toughen up or don't burden anybody else. And we need to learn how to say, no, I'm not okay. I have a good friend who is the chief of staff of a congressman from Michigan. And he just lost his primary race. And I reached out to him. I said, hey, you doing okay? And he said, no, our entire office is not doing okay. Please pray for our country. It's actually okay to say we're not okay. We need to unlearn what the world says when it says don't burden anybody else. We need to learn how to be transparent in the fact that when we see sin, when we see sin around us, when we see something that's not right, we are not okay. Church, God's holy temple will not protect the false idols and temptations. Whether the highest of mountains or the lowest of valleys, if sin is found in God's people, he's clearly not going to spare them. That's why God is communicating this word of judgment through an outsider like Micah. Not the religious leader in the city, but an outsider, an outside prophet from the countryside like Micah. God commands the world to tremble, the mountains to shake, the earth to rumble. God condemns idolatry. God condemns idol worship. God condemns sin. And God teaches us through Micah about this emotion, about this desperation, about this anguish and grief and this lament when it comes to sin. Why? Because we can't just brush it aside. We can't just sweep it under the rug. While I was in California, I had a chance to spend some time with some relatives and cousins who have walked away from the Lord. And it hurts my aunts and uncles quite a bit. They don't know what to do. They keep trying to say, you need to go to church, you need to go to church. And I said, that's the wrong way to go. My aunts and uncles would come to me privately and say, well, James, you're a minister. What do I need to do? And I was like, well, I'm not your pastor. I'm your nephew. But we need to pray. And I've been praying. And I said, well, what is going on? Are you in anguish or are you just annoyed? And I was like, thank you, God. In that moment, that was a perfect question to ask my uncle. Are you annoyed that your loved one, that your son, that your daughter is not walking with the Lord and ran away from the Lord? Or are you in anguish? And then I pushed my uncle a little further. I said, have you fasted? Have you fasted for your son? Have you cried out to the Lord? Beyond just annoyance of, I can't believe he's going to church. He's not going to church. And he's living in sin too. And I said, have you desperately cried out to the Lord? Like your life, you're in a life in that situation. Or have you just been crying out because you're just annoyed? And it was almost like God was trying to teach me in that moment, not just use me in that moment, but also teach me and go, wow, actually, I needed to hear that. Because I wasn't looking forward to this family reunion, because I knew I have some cousins who were very awkward with me, because they're like, oh, I don't want you to throw religion at me. But that's when I knew that when it comes to sin, when it comes to situations like this with people walking away from the Lord, I can't just sweep it under the rug. I need to do what Micah's teaching us here, that what God's teaching us through Micah, this anguish, this cry, this grief, this lament. Then maybe, I'll get a taste of what God's judgment is and what God's grace is, so that I can share that. Church, may these words challenge us this week. There's things that you see in our country right now probably that annoy you. But is it something where we need to be annoyed? Or is it something that we need to be in anguish, where we desperately cry out to the Lord? You might have loved ones that have walked away from the Lord. You might have loved ones that are living in sin. But is it something where you need to stand annoyed? Or is it something where you need to bring your anguish and desperation cry to the Lord? Let us pray. Jesus, we thank you for using the prophet Micah to teach us about your word of judgment. We thank you, O Lord, that we are still standing, no matter how much sins we might have lived through, we're still standing because you called us and called us your beloved, called us your own. So Lord, we pray that we too may not live into the language of the world, but language of the word, where rather than being annoyed at sin, may we be in anguish and lament and grief, so that we can witness one day, soon and very soon, the proclamation of the gospel to the ends of all the earth. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. I invite us to rise once again in body or in spirit as we respond to the word with the hymn, "The ends of all the earth shall hear, the ends of all the earth shall hear."
Sure.
Amen. You may be seated. This time we've come to a time in our service to bring our offerings and tithes to the Lord. The offering plates are available in the back with offering envelopes. Online giving is available through Zelle and through Venmo. The information is on the screen in front of you, as well as if you would like to send a check to the church office, the church address, please notate on the memo line the service date as well. Let's pray for these offerings and our tithes. Jesus, we stand in awe of you once again, that you can use these offerings and tithes for your glorious sake. Lord, I stand in awe of what I experienced last month in our missions trip, where an offering that I thought, Lord, was small, was utilized in incredible and powerful ways. So, Lord, I pray that as we give unto you, Lord, would you encourage us? Would you remind us that, Lord, you are the one that can multiply it and magnify it in ways that we can't even imagine? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we also pray for those in our church family who have various needs, unspoken and spoken. We pray for those who are battling various battles as well. Pray that your grace may abound. And Father, I also lift up our brother Michael as he asks for prayer for his in-laws, Lord, especially with his father-in-law. Father, I pray that as decisions need to be made for his father-in-law, as he continues to try to be there for his wife and his brother-in-laws as well, Father, I pray that you may be with Michael, bless him, encourage him. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you may also be with his in-laws and the entire extended family, Lord, as they continue to grasp with the what-ifs, as they continue to grasp in the potential next chapters of their lives as well. Father, be with Michael's father-in-law as well. Pray that you may be near to him and be God for him as well. We thank you once again for the power of prayer. We thank you for the power of the gospel. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen. Invite us to rise once again as we end our worship with the doxology and the benediction. Benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that's so irresistible that no matter how many times we've tried to run away, it has brought us back. May the love of God the Father Almighty, that's so incredible that it uplifts our spirits in times where we least expect. May the fellowship of the Holy Spirit that embraces us and that reminds us we are your beloved bless each and every saint now and forevermore, and all God's people say, amen.